Hello, everyone. My name is Lisa Loustaunau, and today we're going to be looking at the subject of non-characterological trauma. This subject is particularly important at this moment in time as the world finds itself in the grips of the coronavirus pandemic and consequently in the midst of a collective trauma experience. In this presentation, I will be speaking specifically about what I am calling non-characterological trauma, often known as shock trauma, which I am defining as trauma whose origins are not directly related to the mishandling of a basic developmental need during childhood. For example, safety or security, nourishment, autonomy. And trauma that occurs once or more than once, and whose effects are such that a severe dysregulation of the nervous system occurs, which then impacts emotions, cognition, behavior, memory, energy regulation, the sense of self, and relationships. In core energetics, what we typically work with are the long-term consequences of early wounding that occur when basic childhood developmental needs are not adequately met. In other words, wounding that comes from the mishandling of one or several of a child's basic needs. These deficits, in early experience become deeply embedded in how we think, how we feel, how we breathe, how we move through space, how we relate, and how we use our energy, as well as in the physical shape of our body. This composite is called our character structure. Character structure is egosyntonic. In other words, our ego identifies our way of being as known, as familiar. This is why real growth and transformation is often referred to as a journey, because it's hard work to step out of our known experience, our familiar ways of being, even though the known is causing us suffering. This is most frequently the lens that we work through as core practitioners in helping our clients to heal the internal conflicts, the patterns, the energetic splits that restrict their life force energy and which hide their higher self gifts that we have all incarnated to bring forth. So we also at times encounter profound childhood trauma that is significantly beyond what can be called a deficit or a mishandling of a basic need. Tragically, these are wounds that are devastatingly severe and ongoing, often compounded by the fact that they are inflicted by the very people that were entrusted to keep the child safe. Child trauma is certainly the worst kind of trauma and often results in severe pathology later in life. In both the above instances, however, the character wounding or the childhood trauma happened when a child's personality is still in formation, and so therefore that individual is shaped within and around the context of that trauma. The trauma I'm going to be talking about today, I describe as non-characterological trauma, because the trauma event or events happen after the basic personality or the character has been established. The trauma, therefore, overlays that basic personality, but then creates profound changes in the felt sense of who one is, how one behaves, and what one cares about. And so there is a deep sense of loss of identity, a loss of capacity to experience life as it was once known and understood. As already mentioned, we are referring to trauma whose origins are not directly related to the mishandling of basic developmental needs. It's trauma that occurs once or more than once, and that affects a severe dysregulation in the nervous system. Some examples are natural disasters, the sudden death of a child or loved one, war, the displacement of refugees, intense bullying, domestic abuse,
crime, any overwhelming event that disrupts the flow of what we would normally call normal life. Even what we're experiencing now, the coronavirus, will surely have effects in the long run. Frequently, the effect of this kind of trauma is a syndrome known as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. I sometimes call it post-traumatic soul disorder. PTSD includes three categories of problems: episodic remembering or flashbacks, emotional anesthesia, and sympathetic hyperarousal. We will go deeper into all of these momentarily. It's important to recognize that PTSD is not a mental illness. It's not a moral failure. It's actually proof of our humanity. So let's take a look at flashbacks. Flashbacks are different from normal memory. These are memories that come unexpectedly, out of nowhere. The experience feels as if it is happening in the present. They are intrusive, re-experiencing of the trauma events that a person feels unable to just turn off. A flashback is a dissociative experience in that the person loses their grounding. In other words, their contact with the present moment, their surroundings, and they lose their ability to make contact with their own selves and with others. Another symptom of PTSD is emotional anesthesia. This is where an individual cannot bring their whole self into the present, and they therefore miss the connection and the healing of their personal experiences. They no longer feel fully alive because they are disengaged from life. The individual also exhibits many avoidant behaviors, so they avoid thoughts, feelings, or conversations related to the trauma. Once again, no longer fully feeling alive because this person feels disengaged from life. There is a loss of appetite and desire for people, for companionship, or for intimacy. This person feels as if they don't have a full set of feelings. Often, a person may not want to do things that they used to love doing. There's a loss of pleasure and meaning in relationships and in the everyday tasks. There is no looking forward to the future and no longer feeling fully engaged in life. The third indicator of PTSD is dysregulation of the nervous system. This will express itself in one of two ways, either in sympathetic hyperarousal or in parasympathetic arousal. In sympathetic hyperarousal, there is too much adrenaline in the nervous system. The person becomes jumpy, startles easily, doesn't sleep well, is easy to anger, and can become aggressive. They have difficulty concentrating, are hypervigilant, often experience nightmares, panic attacks, and in general are intolerant of any kind of surprise or sudden movement. In parasympathetic arousal, the dorsal vagus kicks into action. This creates an experience of freezing, numbing, or fainting, and usually occurs when the threat feels so dramatic that there is no other way to get away. This is, in a sense, the ultimate escape. So we've been looking at how PTSD changes arousal levels in the nervous system, causing dysregulation of the mind and the body. The result is a loss in the capacity to respond. And instead, a person reacts because they are, in essence, overtaken in one of the two ways that we just mentioned. In this chart, we see the correlation of three arousal zones and the polyvagal hierarchy of Stephen Porges. So the zone in the center is the optimal arousal zone. It is often called the window of tolerance. In this zone, a person is grounded, connected to self and others, and is appropriately responsive.
The essential nature of this zone is a sense of basic safety. The parasympathetic side is basically relaxed connection with self or with other, and is both restorative and nurturing. The sympathetic side is active, alert, and excited, but yet grounded, aware, present, and connected. This happens, usually we see in play and sex. Porges called this the social engagement system. In core energetics, we see this as the zone where pleasure happens. So, of course, we want to make this window larger. So now let's look up here. This is the sympathetic fight or flight response that is naturally activated when a person feels threatened. This is a healthy survival strategy when the danger is real. Fighting for your life or running away are life-affirming responses to danger. However, in trauma, we become hyper-aroused, not by real present-day danger, but by a memory or a trigger or a perceived attack. The individual is ungrounded and dysregulated. This is sometimes called amygdala hijack, though more than just the amygdala is actually involved. Imagine the long-term stress of constantly repeating triggers that are present in PTSD. This will create a situation where cortisol production, which is the survival hormone, doesn't shut down as it should after any danger has usually passed. Elevated amounts of cortisol leads to depression, to fatigue, and ultimately damages the part of the brain called the hippocampus. This is an area of the brain that connects the emotional part of the brain with the frontal cortex, or the part where cognitive functions happen. So it is also very involved in new memory and learning. Adults who have experienced severe physical or sexual abuse, as well as veterans with PTSD, have been found to have smaller than usual hippocampus. I don't know the plural of that, hippocampi. I'm not quite sure how you'd say that. And a smaller hippocampus correlates to more dissociative functions. So it exhausts the nervous system. So I personally think we need to be prepared to see a tremendous spike in PTSD among our medical personnel who have been tirelessly fighting the COVID pandemic. Here in the United States, that's going to be further compounded by the unfortunate presence of way too much public denial and resistance to really grasping the extent of the danger. So finally, let's look down here at parasympathetic immobilization, often called hyperarousal. This is activated by the dorsal vagus when the organism feels an imminent threat to life. The organism freezes for a prolonged period or essentially faints in a dissociated collapse. This again can be seen to be life-preserving when the threat to life is real. There is a collapse of the life force, and so in that, the organism essentially mimics deadness. Imagine in war how this could potentially protect someone from getting shot or killed. So in trauma, deadening the life force becomes the means to survival, in many ways akin to what we in core energetics see in the severe schizoid characterology.
In addition to the symptoms of PTSD we have already addressed, the problems are frequently compounded with drug and alcohol abuse, a deep sense of being broken, as well as crushing self-blame and guilt that is known as survivor's guilt for having survived the trauma that others around you did not.
So I'm now going to show you some movie clips from some movies that you may have seen that have some examples of PTSD and the behaviors you will see.
You're okay. You're safe. Okay, you're here with me. You're with me.
All the ice cream I could eat. And guess what? A good friend of mine was in the bed right next door. Lieutenant Dane, I got you some ice cream. Lieutenant Dane, ice cream.
It's time for your bath, Lieutenant. Harper?
Cooper? Larson? Webster? Gump?
Is that song really playing?
We have music sometimes.
That song is killing me. Could you please turn it off?
I can't.
What do you mean you can't?
I don't have the controls. I'm sorry.
Did Dr. Timbers put you up to this? Is there a speaker here? Is it a speaker here?
I'm sorry, okay? I'll fix all this, okay?
How do you pick up the threads of an old life? How do you go on when in your heart you begin to understand there is no going back? There are some things that time cannot mend, some hurts that go too deep, that have taken hold.
Little secret, okay? wake your sister.
So I guess I killed her, right? I'm trying to stop thinking that, but I can't. She keeps driving away and dying.
Call the police and send them to my house.
Stop her. I'm crazy again.
No, Charlie, listen to me. Mom and Dad are going to be home with Chris any second.
Just thinking. What if I wanted her to die, Candace?
What? Charlie? Charlie!
It is very important that it be diagnosed early, because the longer you have it, the more you begin to start thinking of this as who you really are, and so the prognosis decreases. The person starts to feel that they desire to suffer out of some distorted moral sense. Symptoms that persevere 1 month following the trauma is typical PTSD. Symptoms that persevere 3 months following an event is named chronic PTSD. Symptoms that are chronic PTSD layered over characterological early severe trauma is now compounded chronic PTSD. Don't ever assume you know the worst part of the trauma experience. A client will often test you to see just how much you can tolerate.
In this section, I will offer a general framework of treatment and describe just a few of the many interventions core energetics practitioners use in treating trauma. All good therapy happens within the context of a safe space, what we call the container. This hinges on the establishment of the relationship, so it's important to see the whole person, not just their issue or problem. We begin by sensing their higher self, that innate integrity which has become dismembered by the trauma experience. It's important to slow yourself down and be willing to slow the client down. Hold space for the broad outlines of the experience rather than try to rush into the entire trauma narrative. Assure the client that there will be time for this.
We emphasize the relationship because it is the relationship with the practitioner that supports the client in growing their energetic capacity to contain the trauma events. In other words, to become larger than the event or the events themselves. Becoming larger or feeling ourselves larger means that we can hold that experience within us. It's not something that overtakes us. So we, in remembering, can stay membered, can stay integrated in the remembering of the event. In core, we call this process containment. You've been hearing the expression expanding the window of tolerance. that is essentially the same thing. To expand containment is to expand the window of tolerance. Containing means to be able to tolerate and hold within us the discomfort of feelings without collapsing, freezing, acting out in reaction, defending, or denying. And so we want to support a safe reconnection to the body. We want to support the client in finding safety and sensation in the sensations of their body, because it is in their body that they can hold the experience without the body and the nervous system becoming overwhelmed. Because traumatized clients often feel overwhelmed by their sensations and feelings, they may cut off and numb themselves. For some, even the elevated heart rate from exercising can be experienced as re-traumatizing. Others go in the direction of overstimulating themselves in order to not feel their pain and their anguish. So it's paramount to support safe reconnection to the body and its sensations. We do this with grounding exercises, beginning gently at first, with breath work that helps to deepen and widen the breath and lengthen the exhalation, and with work that supports to free the diaphragm so that the client can both inhale and exhale fully and create flow between chest and abdomen. We also want to support more self-awareness by inviting the client to notice sensations and feelings, shifts in breath, posture, levels of sensation and tensions. The therapist may ask, for example, did you notice that you just pulled back in your chair, that you just crossed your arms or tightened your jaw or looked away? At times, the therapist may also mirror the client's position to support awareness of their body language, perhaps inviting the client who cannot yet report what they are experiencing in themselves, and instead to observe and comment on what they see in you as you mirror their body position and posture. So, for example, a couple of days ago, I mirrored a young woman's movement of looking down and covering her face. And after asking her what she was feeling, she was not able to answer. So I asked her if she were to guess what I might be feeling when I stood in that way. Her answer was shame. So as we know, one of the important symptoms in PTSD is energy dysregulation. As it turns out, working with energy regulation is one of the tools that core energetics practitioners are most familiar with, because we work with the charge-discharge cycle all the time. What's interesting is that many traditional therapies and many somatic practices as well, somatic therapies, tend to work with methodology that down-regulates the nervous system. In other words, are trying to keep the individual within their window of tolerance. And as we saw from one of the previous slides, the window of tolerance is that area where pleasure can happen, where a person can stay connected and grounded to themselves, to the reality of what is going on, and basically does not lose themselves in what we called at one point amygdala hijack. Interestingly, those tools that are about down-regulating, grounding, quieting, sensing, presencing, breathing, are all the tools that we use as well, particularly at the beginning of our process. However, once a client is more able to do some of that on their own and can get a sense of when they're ungrounded, can get a sense of when they're beginning to get ungrounded, and then can apply breathing or grounding or a discharge posture to help them to cycle down, now we can begin to also use upregulating experiences, which what these will do will be to increase the window of tolerance. Again, that is that window of groundedness in which a person can stay regulated. But in core energetics, we see the value of widening that window because it widens the capacity to feel more, to take in more, to be with greater charge, to feel more passionate in life, to be able to be with excitation without becoming dysregulated. And so being able to stay grounded in higher intensity situations, which I think is a hallmark of really good mental health. And so our upregulating experiences, interventions, are those that work with charging the system, okay? So hitting, kicking, basically breathing, which is also a charging, but focusing on the inhalation to increase the charge in the body. These are all upregulating interventions. So here's our charge-discharge cycle, which most of us are quite familiar with. If you're not, this is a four-beat cycle initially developed by Wilhelm Reich. And core energetics is an outgrowth of one of the earlier of the early Reichian modality, continues to use it. And so the four beats are excitation, charge, discharge, and integration. So these are also the four beats that one sees in the orgasm cycle. Excitation through charge, orgasm, discharge, and integration. So we use this very deliberately and consciously in our work with our clients. And as I said, at a particular moment in time, it will be really useful for our clients that have suffered from trauma. So what happens is that if we can increase this window of tolerance by increasing the excitation, in other words, that's the moment at which we, when a person would normally begin to collapse, to say it's enough, if we can support that person to just stay with the charging a little bit longer, just stay with it, tolerate a little more, be with it a little longer, we bring this up cycle a little bit higher, and then the release is a little bit deeper, a little bit longer. And in that deeper release, that higher up cycle, that lower low cycle, what we are actually doing is expanding the window of tolerance. And that is really one of the unique tools that we have at our disposal and that we are trained to work with.
The term window of tolerance comes from Dr. Dan Siegel, a psychiatrist whose interest has been in interpersonal neurobiology, and it refers to the normal brain-body reactions, in particular following adversity, that has to do with the natural ebb and flow between sympathetic activation and parasympathetic settling. So let's look at the edges of the window of tolerance in this video of a baby laughing when it hears its mother blowing her nose. This clip, which was originally from one of those funniest videos TV shows, is frequently used by Somatic Experiencing founder Peter Levine, which is where I first saw it. In this playing of the baby, you're going to see the baby cycle to the very edges of arousal. Of parasympathetic freeze, alternating with high sympathetic arousal in the intense laughter. The relationship with the mother is what supports the baby to stay just within its window of tolerance and in the social engagement system. So charge and discharge techniques are important
because they expand the energy container such that a client can become larger than the trauma itself. Just to recap, charge means to add or build energy in the entire body or in a particular area of the body that may not have enough energy in it, enough charge. To discharge means to distribute energy in order to create flow through more of the body. This also supports the release of held feelings. The building of resilience in the nervous system occurs not only as the client relates the story or stories, but can also do so while staying fully present and grounded without numbing or dissociating or collapsing. The other very critical component is to be able to express all the unexpressed feelings, as well as to begin to recapture what I call the lost movements that couldn't happen in the midst of the trauma. So let me give you an example of what I mean by recapturing the lost movements. For example, many individuals who have been sexually molested had to dissociate, collapse, or energetically freeze as their only ego defense in order to psychically withstand the experience. In core energetics, when the time is right, we would move the client in the direction of experiencing an intervention that would support the client to integrate the movement of successfully pushing away the molester. In other words, to integrate the protective fight response to offset the internalized freeze response and to allow the expression of all that could not be expressed at the time of the trauma. What might that look like? If the client has done sufficient preparatory groundwork, where they can tolerate being on their back, if this was the position they were in when the trauma occurred, then I would ask the client to lie down and encourage them to begin to pushing with the full force of their arms and legs to essentially fight off the aggressor. I would also encourage and support any spontaneous vocalizations that wanted to emerge. Whatever naturally wants to happen with these movements. In these movements, we are charging the body, building the energy and the fullness of the feelings. At a certain moment in time, the client will naturally tire from the strong movement and expression. Then at this point, we ask the client to assume what is known as a discharge posture, a posture that will encourage the movement of energy through the body in the form of spontaneous vibrations. With these vibrations, the nervous system is being recalibrated, and energy is moving in new ways within the body. Also, new feelings and sensations may emerge, often in waves. Following the discharge stage comes the relaxation stage. Here the client lets go, releases, and surrenders. This is deeply integrating, satisfying, and also feels really, really good. In what I have just described, we are encouraging the recapturing in current time of very real, felt, and expressed experience of power and courage, followed by relaxation and integration in the face of the trauma story. This is what helps a client not just live with the trauma, but take back their lost power, their lost movements. Take back the lost piece of their soul that they left in that trauma experience so they can move forward with their life with a greater capacity for pleasure and connection. To learn about training in core energetics, visit the International Association of Core Energetics, IACE, website and go to the Participating Institutes page. There you will find links to programs around the world, including the USA, Europe, Mexico, Australia, and Brazil. Several of these sites will also have links to a practitioner directory if you are interested in working with a core practitioner. If you'd like to contact me, Lisa Loustaunau, you can do so at ll4core@gmail.com or visit my website, lisaloustaunau.com. Thank you. Take care.